Shout to the Lord, all the earth let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name.
I just love watching children, and it reminds me of my sister-in-law when she was 3 years old and she was sitting in the church and everyone was singing and she didn't know the words, so she stood on the church clapping her hands and singing Billy Vali. That's the words that she knows. But it's just amazing how even children can worship God in the way that they feel comfortable. So it's awesome. Children are really a blessing. So the mothers, it's Mother's Day. Let's just raise your hands. Where's all the moms this morning? Did you get the chocolate and the little message? You got those? That's a really special. Mothers are really special. It's one of the most highly unpaid jobs in the world, being a mom. Most expensive job in the world. People can't even actually afford to have their mom or at home because it's just too expensive. So people have to actually go and work. But mothers are actually so special. And this morning, I want you to feel special because there's so much that you guys do. You care for us, look after us, make sure that we've got warm clothes, make sure that there's food on the table. And you're the ones that make the atmosphere in the house. It's just this awesome, loving, caring atmosphere. And so I want to thank you for the role that you play in our lives. So let's just bow our heads. And if you're a child and you're sitting next to your mom, just hold your mom and just give her a hug while we pray. And then afterwards, the children can actually go to the children's church. Father God, I want to come before you. I want to thank you that you created mothers who are soft, mothers who are caring and loving. Thank you that we can go to them anytime and just know that they're there to help us, to care for us. I want to pray for each and every single one of them here this morning, that you'll just bless them today. May they feel loved today by you, but also by their children. Maybe there's mothers here that are far away from their children. Father, we're thinking of them as well. May they know that their children, wherever they are, love them as well. And may they feel special today. So thank you for this. We want to thank you, Lord, that you're a God that also teaches us, that we must listen to your voice. And to do that, we need to go and spend time with you. And even you, Jesus, you left sometimes the chaos of life and you went off on your own just to get away from everything. And you spent time with your Father. And that's what we're going to do this morning. So with this last song, Lord, we just want to spend time with you. May you guide us and lead us during the rest of the service as well. Amen. Seated. Often in the life of Jesus, he spent so much time ministering to people, and there were also times when he was just overwhelmed with just with life, especially when he heard that John was killed. And he was ministering to so many people, and often those times you'll find in the Word that he disappears. He goes away from everyone, away from the crowds, away from all the busyness of life. And he goes and he spends time with his Father. I mean, this is Jesus, God Himself, the Son of God, going away and spending time with God, just listening to His voice. And if Jesus did that, how much more do we have to do that? Don't we all want to hear God's voice? We all want to know that He's talking to us. We all want to know that He's guiding us. We all want to know that He's there. Myself too. And this morning we're going to look at the third element of our series, which is hearing the voice of God. In the first one we did, we spoke about abiding in Christ, how we as Christians, as believers, we like a branch that's connected to a tree trunk, connected to the vine. And when we're connected to that, we're getting supplied by the vine. And we actually become like the vine. So we actually become like Christ. We have the same characteristics that He has. Filled with love. Filled with patience and kindness. And when we do, we start to bear fruit. Fruit that other people can use. And impact other people's lives. And then last week we spoke about, regarding a connected life, we need to be connected to God with regards to loving Him. We need to love Him with our whole heart because He loved us first. Because God is love. And so when we love Him, we become full with His love and then we can love other people. And this morning we're going to talk about how we're going to connect to God by hearing His voice. So let us pray. So Father God, this morning, come and speak to us through Your Word. That's why we're here. We're here to learn. We're here to listen. We're here to love You, Father. And so through Your Word, come and open up our eyes and our mind and our thoughts to focus on You in the next few minutes. Amen. I shared with you 2 weeks ago that during the coming weeks, you're going to learn a little bit about my story and my wife's story as well, how we came to the point that we decided to come to Australia, specifically to do ministry, because that was what God called us to do. And when I share some of these testimonies, please see it as testimonies and not to elevate myself. Many of you I've spoken to over the last 3 weeks have got similar stories where God has been speaking to you. And you can share those testimonies, and we should. That's what we ought to do. We've got to share what God is doing in our lives. And many of the small groups, I've been to a few of them, and they've just shared some of those stories, and it's awesome to hear. So when I explain some of these things that we're going through, just see it as God working. And I don't reflect on myself, because God speaks to all of us. But we came to a point where we were constantly praying and constantly focusing on God and asking Him to speak to us with regards to our ministry, our calling, and with regards to where. And this was a 2-year process that we went through, constantly asking God, listening to His voice. And on one Sunday, we watched the DVD of William Carey. Now, William Carey was a missionary in the early 1800s. And he was a missionary. And he decided he wanted to go from England and he wanted to go do mission work in India. It wasn't like today's world where you can climb up on an aeroplane and tomorrow you're in South Africa or in America and then you can fly back again. No, you've got to climb on a ship and it takes a couple of weeks there and then you're practically giving up the whole life. It's going to be difficult to go back. And so he took his wife and 2 boys at that time and they went over to India to start doing missionary work. And when they came, it was so difficult because 1, they didn't understand the culture. 2, they couldn't speak the language, and so they had to learn the language. And 3, they were hit with terrible diseases and stuff. So much so that the youngest child died. And later, the wife became senile because everything that she just couldn't cope with what's happening. And later on, the other child also died at a young age. And so too, unfortunately, the wife as well, at a young age, passed away as well. But his work continues still today. He was able to start the first printing press in India, and a lot of the Bibles that were translated in that language is as a result of the work that he did. So it wasn't unfruitful, but it was difficult. And so we watched this DVD, and afterwards we were like, whew, mission work is real difficult. And we just had a discussion, we were talking about it. And one of the things that stood out, especially for Sonia, was no, we can't do mission work because of the language. She's really scared that we're one day going to go to China because I just want to go to China. And you've got to learn Chinese and you've got to read backwards to find all those things. They're quite difficult. So one of the concerns she had that day was, no, but I can't speak their language. What if God sent us to a country which we can't speak their language? And I said, I don't know, God will help us. I mean, the Holy Spirit helps you with those things. And I don't know where He's calling us exactly. Although we sort of knew at that stage. We sort of had a heart for Australia. But we were still seeking His voice. And then afterwards, that Sunday afternoon when we spent time in prayer, sitting in the lounge, we were just talking and we took out the scripture which we're going to read this morning. We took John 10, where it stands that my sheep know my voice. And we prayed that. We said, God, we are your sheep. We are your children. You've called us and you know that we must listen to your voice. You've created us to listen. You've created us in a manner that we can hear your voice. So we shouldn't struggle about these things. So speak to us about our calling and show us. And at that time, we were working through the Old Testament together as husband and wife. And the very next passage that we read was Ezekiel 3. Ezekiel 3 says that I'm sending you to a country where they know your language. And we're like, wow. Wow, for two reasons. Number one, firstly, we don't have to go learn all sorts of different languages. That's awesome. But wow, because God spoke. And we heard Him speak. And God speaks to us daily. We're not always aware of it. So turn with me to your Bibles in John 10 from verse 1. John 10 from verse 1. You can just open up there. I'm going to read from 1 to 5. Jesus said, I'm telling you the truth. The man who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in some other way, is a thief and a robber. The man who goes in through the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him. The sheep hear his voice as he calls his own sheep by name and leads him out. I'll just stop there for now. I'm going to just read another translation, New King James Version, which I have. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs up some other way, the same is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the doorkeeper opens, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. And when he brings out his own sheep, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. For they know his voice. Now, just to get understanding of verse 1, is we need to go to chapter 9. In chapter 9, Jesus heals a blind man. A man who was blind since he was born. And he heals him. He does a miracle. And wow, this guy can now see. And so the people see this, and they take the blind man to the leaders, the religious leaders, the Pharisees. And they go show him and see what God has done. And then these Pharisees ask him and question him, but who did this? And he answers him, he says, it was a man named Jesus. And these Pharisees say, no, they can't be. It can't be him. Because he's a liar. He says that he's the Son of God. And it can't be him. And the man says, well, you've got to believe. I can see. If it wasn't him, who else was it? Because it was him. There's no other. And so they go to his parents. They say, was this man blind? And they say, yes. He says, but who healed him? And they were scared of these religious leaders. So they said, no, ask him. He's of age. Because they don't want to answer. Because as soon as they answer and they say, but it was Jesus, then they'll be thrown out of the temple, thrown out of the place of worship. And so they ask him again, and he says, it was the man named Jesus. Don't you believe in him? You're supposed to be his followers. And to take it back to this scripture, to the thief and the robber, that's what Jesus is talking about in this passage. He's talking about people that take you away from him. They come and try and steal you. And just the same, in those times, the religious leaders were trying to warn them, saying, this is not the Son of God, keep him away, his teachings are wrong. Just the same, in today's world, there's people that teach us, no, but there's many ways to God. There's many different types of ways. And they try and steal us and say, no, but those things are all lies. It's the same in today's God, nothing's changed. People that try and take us away from the shepherd. And then Jesus makes a profound statement. He says that he's the shepherd in verse 2. He's making a profound statement. He says, the only way to God is through me. John 14, verse 6, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Whoever goes to my Father goes through me. He's making a profound statement saying he's the only way. There's no other way. There's no other way to be saved. There's no other way to have eternal life except to believe in Jesus Christ. And yet in today's world we find people saying, no, there's different ways and we've got to be open to everyone. Yes, we love everyone. But there's only way to the Father. And that's through Jesus. And Jesus is confirming here that He's the Messiah. He's the King of Kings. And He's coming back again. And when He comes, He's coming for me and you. Will you believe? And then He goes on and He says, to Him the doorkeeper opens and the sheep hear His voice. And He calls out His own sheep by name. The sheep hear His voice. Now, today I'm going to just share a little bit about sheep. I'm not a sheep farmer. I used to work with Umkali at Moreleta Church. I used to work with him and he's a good friend of mine. And he used to farm with sheep. And so he's got quite a good understanding of sheep. And often I used to sit in his office and we used to talk about sheep. And then we used to relate it back to the Scriptures because the Scriptures is filled with sheep. So he taught me a number of things about sheep. But the sheep, the way we do sheep farming in today's context is totally different to sheep farming in those times. And in fact, the Middle East still uses some of those methods. So what would happen is the sheep, because of the patches of grass, because it's the Mediterranean area, there's mountain area, there won't be green fields like here in Australia and these wide patches of grass in some areas and in South Africa as well, the way they fall. So because of that, they used to have to take the sheep to small patches of grass. So once that grass is up, they used to look for new places and go there as well. But then at night, they used to come and they used to put them into a sheepfold, a place where they were safe. And then, unfortunately, the shepherd sometimes used to sleep and they used to hire someone just to look after the sheep at night. But his job was just to be there and make sure that thieves aren't entering, like 1 and 2 says. And so sometimes the thieves used to climb over the gate and try and steal the sheep and take them. And then Jesus comes and he says, but I'm the true shepherd. Those guys are climbing over the sheep pen and I'm the gate. I come through the gate. I come in the right way into your life. And he knows us by name. So then the first thing we hear is that Jesus doesn't say here to us and to his sheep, no, you can try and hear my voice. He says here, my sheep know my voice. And I just want to show you this DVD clip regarding sheep. Just to show you how it practically actually does happen. How sheep know the shepherd's voice.
One more time.
That was good. Tick 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 tick.
Just forgive the language. Forgive them. I don't know if you saw. I've watched it a few times and I noticed quite a few things. But in this video, firstly, these people come, these strangers, and they start calling the sheep. And what do those sheep do? They just nothing. They don't even look up. And then when the farmer comes, firstly, if you look real close, then their ears start to twitch because they're listening. And their heads look up because they see, but it's him. And then they make sure. It takes just a while. They first listen for a little while longer. And their ears continue to twitch up. And then, when they know that it's him, they heard his voice, and they're certain, then in excitement they start running to the shepherd. And that's exactly the same with us. This verse is saying that my sheep know my voice. We're going to get to that a little bit later of sometimes why we don't leer. But they know my voice. And the first thing that he confirms is he says, I call them because I know them by name. So Jesus can sit here this morning or stand here. I don't know everyone's names this morning, but he can. And he can point to each one and every one of you. He can say, there's Johan. I know him. That's Anzel. I know when she hurt her knee when she was a little small little child. I know the things she went through. That's Tanya over there. And he can explain everything that you've ever done. And he knows you by name. They did an experiment in the Mediterranean, in the Middle East, where some of these shepherds were. And they went out and they said, because because there was so little grass, the sheep would actually have to, the flocks would have to mix. So you'll get different shepherds with different sheep in one area. And they did an experiment, they went up to a shepherd and they said, can you call out your sheep? And he said, oh, that's easy. And he started to name them and call them. And as he started to name them and call them, they came out. And that's exactly what Jesus can do. He can name us and call us because he knows us by our names. He knows what you like. He knows what you don't like. He knows how he created you. Some of us like to listen to music. Others enjoy doing other things. He created you in that way and he knows you by name. And that's just fantastic to know. The shepherd knows us by our name. And then the verse continues is, and he calls out his sheep by name and leads them out. What is the responsibilities of a shepherd? What is the responsibilities of Jesus, if we think about this thing? The first thing that we need to understand is sheep were such a valuable commodity and still are. In those days, sheep provided a way that you could have income, a way that you could put food on the table, a way that you could make clothes. So sheep were highly valuable. And in fact, they were so valuable that the farmers were taught that they mustn't sell their land, they mustn't sell sheep to buy land. They must rather sell their land to buy sheep. Sorry, I got that all wrong. They must sell their land in order to buy sheep. So sheep were more valuable than property. And if that's the case, and God's saying this morning is that you are valuable. And that's why a shepherd's role is so important. Because here we see the first thing that a shepherd has to do is lead the flock. So that shepherd would take the sheep through mountainous area and go look for places of where they can eat pastures, places where they can drink water, and places where they can be safe. So he would go in front of them, leading them. And when he calls them, just like in the video, they'll follow. And sometimes what would happen is that the shepherd would actually have to go through streams of water. So what the shepherd would do is he would make sure that it's safe. He would go through the water, through the stream, and make sure it's not too deep for everyone and all the sheep can come through, even the little ones. And then what would happen, he would stand on the other side and call the sheep over. And then the mature ones, the ones that are older, who know him very well, would follow. They would just plod along. But then you would get the little ones, those that are not sure. They would be uncertain and hesitant and sort of like, oh no, I can't do this now. And then they would eventually start following. But what would happen is sometimes they would struggle because they were in distress. They were stressed. They didn't realize, but hey, I can actually walk through here. And they would become stressed. And then what the shepherd would do is he would see and he would climb into the water and catch them and take them across. And Jesus does that exactly the same with us. Sometimes we go through difficult times. We go through difficult places. And then Jesus is right in front of us as the shepherd, guiding us and leading us. And sometimes it's dangerous. It looks difficult. There's life is difficult, let's be honest with each other this morning. We go through difficult circumstances. But what Jesus says is, I'm with you. I'm leading you through it, and I'm there with you. Have a look at Isaiah 43. And just read it for us. This is so beautiful. When I read this piece about the shepherds actually taking sheep practically through water, then I read Isaiah 43 and it was so amazing. It says, but now, thus says the Lord who created you, O Jacob, and who formed you, fear not, I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. There it is. Isaiah applying the principle that a shepherd is right there with his sheep, guiding them through waters. And Isaiah uses it and says, God is with you through difficult times as well. He's right there. And he's calling you over. He's calling you. He's talking to you the whole time. Telling you, come. Pass through. Then if it's difficult, he says, but here I am. I'll pick you up. I'll take you over. Just follow my voice. Follow my voice. Listen to it. And then the second role of a shepherd is to take care of you. Because he has the shepherd taking those sheep to better places. Places where they can eat. Places where they can drink water. Places where they can rest. And the shepherd leads them there. And God says, I want to take you to these same places. Listen to my voice. And he cares for us. He takes care of our needs. He clothes us. He looks after us. He provides for us. Exactly the same like a shepherd does. And we are worth more than sheep. Much more than sheep. And he cares for the sheep. And then the third thing is that he does is he protects the sheep. Protects them from danger. They have to go through mountainous areas. But also he protects them from the dangers of life. Those thieves, those robbers, we think of David who protect the sheep from lions. People that are trying to destroy us. Things that are trying to destroy us. One of the biggest things that tries to destroy us is Satan and his works. Here it stands in verse 10. It says that the thief does not come except to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Now let's make it a little bit practical this morning. We think of drugs. Packaged in a little pill, or packaged in a little white powder, innocent looking, and marketed, no, this is going to take away all your problems. This is going to make your life feel better. You're going to feel so good. You're going to experience things, and don't worry, all your fears and your problems and everything is going to go away. And oh man, what a lie it is. Total nonsense. Drugs is there to destroy you. It destroys your body. If you think of people that take drugs, then not only does it destroy your body when you use it, but it destroys relationships. It destroys family life. It destroys many people, it destroys that person's own life. And yet, so many people are falling to it. Heard so many stories here in Australia as well, people falling to meth. You see, that's what Satan does. He comes and packages sin in this beautiful little wrapping like this. And when you open it up, you find it's disgusting, a stench, and it's damaging to us. Destroys our lives, steals from us, and eventually can even kill you, some of them. Like murder, like taking drugs. You see, that's what Satan does. He makes sin look enticing. And yet it's bad for us. Real bad. We were in Brazil twice now, ready for a mission trip, as some of our members in the church. And we were in the most ravaging areas with regards to drugs. We were in some of the most dangerous areas. There were places where we were, where literally in the middle of the street were teenage boys with guns, protecting the drug lords and protecting the area as well. And one of the teams were called out on the morning to a lady whose daughter had just been killed the day before. And they were called out to the house. They weren't exactly sure what was happening, but they were going to go minister to this lady. And when they got there, they found out that that daughter was killed right in the street, right in front of where they were sitting, a day before. Drugs killing people. Sin killing people. Now we might think, oh, but that's bad things. I don't do drugs. And what about alcohol? No, I don't. But then there's also smaller things, white lies. Destroys lies, which become bigger and bigger and bigger. And today I can go through all of them, but that's not the point. The point is that Jesus, the shepherd, wants to take us out of those things. He wants us to listen to His voice and not to those voices. And just as these sheep didn't react to strangers, didn't react to the world who's calling them and calling, firstly, they were calling them the wrong way, they were calling them the wrong names, they're calling the wrong things, those people. And here comes the shepherd and says the right words, calls in the right manner. That's exactly the same. He wants us to avoid the dangers of life because He wants us to have life and life in abundance, verse 10. I have come that they may have life, and that they may have life more abundantly. The warnings that are written in this book is here for a reason, to give us life in abundance. Back to Brazil. That happened the first time we were there. The second time we were there, one of the teams, actually the whole team went and ministered at a house where a lady kicked out the husband because of drugs. And we went and prayed for her. And then most of us, we went through to other locations in the area. And then this team stayed behind a few days in that lady's house, but also in the area, ministering to her and to the husband on an ongoing basis for the next 2 weeks. And initially, the lady kicked him out. And then they said, okay, but how can we help you as a husband and wife to make sure that you guys don't have to separate? How can we help you through this? And they prayed for them, and they guided them. And then the first thing that happened is that the husband came to church. There we go. The Bible's too heavy. The Word of God is heavy. So the first thing that the team did is invited the husband to church because he was living in a little caravan. She kicked him out of the house and invited him to church. And so he came the one evening, and that was just another step. And they continued to counsel him, continued to love him, and then the pastor continued to walk with both of them. And what's so amazing, about 2 months ago, we got a picture of him being baptized, being accepted, accepting God as his Lord and Savior, as his shepherd, and saying, I'm now a believer. We understand that his life is clean also, being cleansed since then. And he was baptized, and I've got a picture on my phone of him. And that's just amazing. That's the life that God wants to bring, where marriage was restored. I know Shalom, they're coming next week to Awaken. And there we're going to hear just as many testimonies. I know Shalom is a house for over 100 people also, which are in drugs and that. And they're helping people, and lives are being renewed because of that. We've got to listen to God's voice. We've got to hear His voice this morning. Every single day, we're constantly walk with Him. And that's what the first thing is, how do we hear God's voice? I mean, there's so many ways. And that's the problem. We can be so focused on how's God going to speak to me that we're actually not listening. Because whereas the shepherd guides us, whereas the shepherd cares for us, whereas the shepherd protects us, talks to us, your role as a sheep is just to listen. That's all they have to do, is just listen. And to obey. Just those two things. The problem is we're so focused on talking. I mean, I don't know how you spend your time with prayer, but some of the times I can just find myself, I've been talking for 10 minutes and I'm not listening. Going in a society where you just all day long, it's the TV and it's people, and it's just, there's so much stuff influencing our minds and which we can listen to, but we struggle to listen to God. And one of the pastors, he said that he challenged his church to actually record their prayers. Firstly, actually just to listen to what they're saying. But secondly, to start understanding that you must also listen. Just spend some time listening to God's voice. That's sometimes some things that I struggle a lot with. Many times I'll go and I'll just pray and I'll put the prayer request, but I've struggled to listen. How many times do we really listen? And we listen. One of the biggest ways that we can hear God's voice is through His Word. These words that are written here are not just man-made and written down with a pen and something to read. These words were spoken thousands of years ago by God to these people that wrote it down. And they penned word for word what He said. And if you know something about sound waves, when you speak, those sound waves never disappear. They carry on forever. And these words carry on forever. This is God's Word written down, speaking to us. I mean, I want to know what's happening. I don't want to know about my marriage. It's in the Word. I want God to speak to me about my children. How should I be raising them? It's in the Word. I want God to speak. I'm fearful this morning. There's so much fear in me this morning. I can't overcome it. It's in the Word. Doubt. It's in the Word. Romance. It's in the Word. Song of Solomon. Ecclesiastes. Stress. I'm stressed. Stressed about my work. Stressed about my family. Stressed about finances. It's in the Word. We've got to spend more time in the Word. Taking what God says and then listening. I had to do that this week. I think it was Tuesday. There was something specific that I was just thinking of. And I went into the Word and I just spent some time regarding that matter. And I just heard God speaking to me about that. I was overwhelmed. We've got to spend time in God's Word just listening. But here's the thing, it's one thing to listen to His voice and a total another aspect to actually obey His voice. We've got to listen and know, but then we've got to obey. We've got to react to that. So if God's challenging you with something in your life right now and you read the Word and you read it and that's what it says, then you've got to react to that. You've got to respond. Just like the sheep. They could have twitched their ears, oh, that's the shepherd. Carry on. When we react to God and His Word and His voice, then He takes us to all the right places in our lives. He takes us to better places. Just like Psalm 23 says, the Lord's my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me down to lie. In pastures green, He leadeth me to quiet waters. We spent time in prayer yesterday morning as a congregation, as some of the leaders of the congregation. And it was just amazing just to spend that time and just there was all this calmness. It was total calm, just peaceful. That's what God does when we spend time in His presence. And we're going to hear His voice. And when we do, you're going to know that it's God's voice speaking to you. You're going to be able to discern it. You're going to know, okay, that's God speaking to me. And you're going to know all the other things. That's just me, my thoughts. And it's also just the things of the world. God speaks us to the Holy Spirit because He sent the Holy Spirit as the person, it says in John 15 and John 16. The Holy Spirit is the comforter, is our guide, and He'll guide you in truth. So when Jesus talks to you, when God speaks to you, His voice is declaring truth into your life and not the wrong things that the thief comes into to take and destroy. I just want to turn over to verse 11. Jesus confirms that I'm the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives life for the sheep. God wants to give us life this morning. He wants to remind you of the life that we once had when you didn't know Him. And when you listen to His voice, He says, come, follow me. He says, come and follow me. I've got everything you need. There's nothing more. And we can experience that life abundance now. We don't experience when we enter eternity. Because that is the truth. The day that God calls you by your name and you say, I'm going to follow Him. That's the day that you receive eternal life. That's the day that nothing can harm you anymore. That's the day you enter into eternity. All that has to happen now is your physical body has to die. So in other words, we can experience abundant life now. We don't have to wait for one day. And that's what Jesus is saying in this passage. He's saying, I'm the shepherd. I've come to give you life. There's going to be difficult things that you're going to go through, but I'm always there for you. I'll be leading you step by step. Just trust me. Just follow me. Just do what I say. And when you do, those difficult times, those difficult things will pass. Because I'm there with you. And I'll help you. Let us pray. Father God, you want this morning, this just comes and confirms your heart that you're our shepherd. You want to guide us. You want to speak to us. And we want to hear your voice. So Lord, here we are as your sheep. You've called by our names. You know each and every one of us this morning. You know each and every one of us. And you know our struggles. Just right now, there we are. Anything that's struggling or bothering you at the moment, just give it over to God. He's here. He's listening. Lord, you know our joys. The joy of being a mother. The joy of maybe someone receiving a job. Our joys also, Lord, we want to thank you for them. And God knows them. And then some of you have needs. We all have needs. God's yet to listen to those needs. Just give it to Him this morning. And then just hear and know that God says, I'm your shepherd and you can hear my voice. And Father, may we experience you speaking to us during this day and during this week, Father. Where you want to protect us and warn us, but also when you want to comfort us and guide us. And we thank you for that, Lord. We thank you that you're the good shepherd. You don't want our lives to be destroyed. And we want to thank you for that, Father. Amen. I'll ask the worship team to come up just for that last song. Let's stand and worship God.
In Christ alone.
be seated. May you experience this week that God is your shepherd and He speaks to you. My prayer is that each and every one of us will hear His voice. Because He doesn't say you'll most probably hear my voice. You may not think you'll hear my voice. We will hear His voice. So may we each of us spend time in His Word listening to what He has to say and hearing His voice. And when we do, may we also react to that. Just like that family reacted in Brazil and their lives were changed because of that, a much better life than they had. Just like myself and my wife reacted to God's voice, do the same. I know many of you have already. Let's hear God's voice as He guides us. Amen. Just a few announcements for this morning before we close. Here's the first one. There's a weekly prayer gathering on Saturdays. Please come join us at, I know it's a little bit early, 6:30 till about 8:00. If you wake up at 7:00 and you join us at 7:30, that's also okay. But join us at Leeming from about 6:30. We're there to listen to God. We're there to discover God's will for us as people, but most importantly for the congregation as well. Congregation's going through some different things and changing a little bit, and we want to make sure that that was happening is from God. And we pray that God will guide us, because it's His church. So come spend time with us in prayer, seeking God's will for the congregation, but also for your life as well. Then the next one is a women's retreat. Yay! 3 to 5 November. I can't go. I'm not a woman. 206 Cave Road. That's going to take place. It's $95 per person, all inclusive. And we need to register by the 30th of September, I see. All right? By 30th of September. So I know it's quite long ahead, but it is Women's Day. It's not Women's Day. It's Mother's Day. Woman, not Women's Day. But just register now. All right? Don't miss that out. That's an awesome opportunity to just go and just go spend time in God's Word and just be who you are, who God created you, a woman. So that's quite exciting, and hopefully that'll be quite refreshing as well. Then the last one, I spoke about it last week as well, Sunday the 2nd of July till Friday, a sports camp where you can get to, if you've got children and you want to send them away because they're bothering you and they've got nothing else to do and they're at home bothering you, then you can send them to the camp. No, just joking. Maybe your children want to actually go do some sports, but also spend time in God's Word. And the 2nd to the Friday, the 7th of July, that's an opportunity for them to join as well, $495. We're going to take up the offering now, and then we're going to close. So the leaders can just come and take up the offering. Thank you. Father, thank You for the opportunity that we can give And we just want to pray that you'll bless this as well. That ministry can continue all over. That your voice can be heard all over. That your word can be heard. Yeah, in Perth, but also where everyone might be listening or watching the streaming, Father. So that your word, your voice, can be experienced by all of your sheep. And all of those who you're still calling as to your sheep. We haven't realized that yet. And so we thank you for this. We worship you and we pray that it will be more, much more fruit than it already is doing. Amen. Thank you. If there's anyone just struggling with fear at the moment, like seriously, it's just overwhelming, then I just want to ask you, if you don't want to come, and I'll be here in front for a little while longer as well, if you want to just come join me, I would like to just chat with you as well. All right, let us pray. Father God, I want to thank you that we can hear your voice. Your voice speaks through your word. Your voice speaks also sometimes in different other ways. And we want to thank you for that. Thank you that you are a shepherd and you're guiding us. Lord Jesus, thank you that you're the way, the truth, and the life, and we go through you to be with the Father. And Holy Spirit, thank you that you're guiding us every single day in your truth, which you're teaching us. And may you guide each and everyone this week as well. As we go to our work, as we go to schools, as we go to uni, wherever we're going, may you guide us. Amen. Amen. Coffee and tea at the back. Some guys' fellowship. Enjoy the week.